Good morning. Community East here. We are another Sunday. How about that? First thing that I'd like to do is introduce our minister this morning. She may be small, but she is dynamic. Our wonderful and talented pianist, Arena Goodmacher. And if you'd like to turn to the opening hymn number one, Praise God That Good Is Everywhere.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, and I know they appreciate it. If you would like to turn to hymn number 193 in our hymnals, Festival of Life.
Thank you.
In preparation for today's message, we'd like to begin with the congregational response. And I want you to think about that the words that you're hearing, how your heart is responding to those words. And so as we sing this congregational response, keep those thoughts in mind.
And having fun is, oh,
look at that person doing that, whatever they're doing. I mean, we forget how much fun it is to have fun. Or sometimes we think, oh, what will everyone think? We're so worried about being adult that we forget that, come on, Pete, still a kid in the heart, right? I know it, you know it. But sometimes we just don't want to act like it. So, I mean, have you ever heard the phrase, if you do what you love, you'll never work a day in your life? Well, that's the power of zeal. Zeal is just another word for enthusiasm, and it doesn't matter if it's coming to church, or doing your job, or cleaning your house, or going outside and playing with the kids or the grandkids. You have the choice to make it fun. I mean, we don't control what goes on out there, but we do control what goes on in here. So if there's a little bump in the road, a little blip, this morning, so I was chatting with Linda Guy, one of our president this morning before, when I first walked in, and I went to get something in my purse, and I just went, because I thought I totally left my top at home. Okay. I thought, oh boy, that'll be fun. But that's the way I look at things. I mean, if I didn't, it's here. But that's my new thing. I spend hours writing these talks, and then I go, and wander off into all these other directions. But it's all good. Because the point is to have fun, and that's what I'm talking about today. And I do. Sometimes I'm sorry, I laugh at inappropriate moments. So, I like to refer to a Bible verse from 1 John 4, verse 16. And you know what it says? It says, God is love. So when we're filled with zeal, when we're filled with enthusiasm, we are entheos, enthusiasm. And you know what that means? In God. Love, God, enthusiasm, zeal, it's what we are. We are individualized expressions of God. And that's why I love to use that statement of being at the beginning of the service to remind us that we are individualized expressions of God. The divine spirit lives in, through, and as us. And it wants to have fun. It's love. It's enthusiasm. And, you know, my daughter is in HR. And listen, that's enough. I won't tell you the whole story. She started out working for my husband and I while she was in college, and she was a great employee. I mean, she just, seriously, we owned a property management business where we managed condominium communities and homeowners associations and dealt with boards of directors, and nobody called us, very, very rarely did anyone call us except to tell us about what was wrong. So it's not really a fun job, but you make it fun. Not when you're really talking to your customers, however. I got myself into trouble a couple of times. It was not my fit. I was supposed to be behind the scenes, but didn't quite work out that way all the time. But anyway, when it comes to hiring in HR, you know what? Do you know what the people that hire really look for? The biggest aspect of the person that they hire is their attitude. Are they enthusiastic? Are they excited? Are they somebody that people are going to want to be around? People like to be around. People like to work with, and people would want to work with them. Do you know that people stay at companies where they have fun? That's, people don't like to go to work and it's just boring and mundane and bleh. People want to have fun. And so employers are 10% of an employer's decision to hire is based on skills and training. 10%. 40% on attitude, 25% on image and appearance, and then another 25% on communication skills. So my daughter, I'm going to write about my daughter a little bit. When she left us, her degree was in human resources. And she went to a company, and she did well, and made a lot more money than we made her, so good for her. Anyway, she stayed with that company a while, and unlike, when I was in the work world, people just stayed in the job for like 40 years and retired from that job. And sometimes maybe they did a second career after their first career. But typically, we didn't move around. But that's changed. A lot of things have changed. And after that first job for which she applied and did very well, the next job she got, someone called her and said, "Julie, there's an opening here, and I remember working with you and blah, 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 and I think you ought to come here." So she went there and got the job. And then the next job she got, she went to another company where someone knew her, only this time the person was higher up in the company. And she came in and just sat down and talked to them. She didn't have to go through the interview process with some of the other people in the upper echelon of management, but she got hired there. And if we had a big screen TV up here, I would show you a picture. I would show you a picture of my daughter at one of the first major corporations that she worked for with her team, because she quickly moved into management, where she is jumping about 3 feet off the ground. And it's because she led her team to win some sort of recognition in the HR field, and she was so excited about it, she literally jumped in the air like, yeah! In front of all her team, and somebody snapped a picture. And that enthusiasm has brought her to greater and greater heights in her career. And just yesterday, she called me and told me that on Friday, her former boss from where she works now called her and said, "Julie, I'd like to offer you a vice president position with a pretty good sized company." And she said, well, what about? And she said, "Well then, okay, I'll come in and speak with the CEO, right?" And the HR person, who was her former HR boss, said, "I don't care what he says, you're hired." And that's what my enthusiastic and very talented, don't get me wrong, she's, it's not just because she's cute and fun and all that kind of stuff. She knows her job and she's very good at it. However, that enthusiasm, that zeal, that's why people are calling her and saying, "I want you." Because Julie had worked for now who's going to be her boss again in a few weeks. She had worked for her for 4 years out of however many years she was with that company. And when her boss left, She said, "You're going to work for me again."
Yeah.
She told her in advance, she always kept in touch. And when an opening came up that she thought Julie might be interested in, boom. And that's the way it works. And it's not just in a job. It's in everything that we do. When you're the person who's smiling and having fun and outgoing, making other people feel good, what we give out comes back. So, God kind of put a smile on your face. Charles Fillmore describes zeal as the great universal force that impels us to spring forward in a field of endeavor and accomplish the seemingly miraculous. Nothing gets done without enthusiasm. Do you think that Henry Ford got Detroit and the rest of the world on wheels by being ho-hummy about it? No, I mean, when he was told that there's no way you can make an engine powerful enough that can put inside this machine, they said, the engineers told him, "Nope, sorry, can't be done." And he said, "Yep, and you're going to figure it out. Thank you very much. Come back to me when you got it." And that's what they did. That's what they did, because he said, this has got to happen. We have to make automobiles affordable for the average person. And the only way we can do that is to make them affordably. So we got to figure out how to do that. And he just would not take no for an answer. So, you know, it's like, no matter what we do, there is a divine spirit living in, through, and as us. And it is for us. It wants us to have what we want. It wants us to be happy. It wants us to be healthy. Healing comes from happiness. Healing comes from doing what we love, from having an attitude of gratitude. We are individualized expressions of God. We are divine. That is our nature. That is who and what we are. We are temporarily having this physical human experience, while we always were, still are, and always will be, that spirit, that spiritual being that we are now, was, is, and always shall be. We are individualized expression of the One. We're not separate. It looks like we're separate, but we're not. I was sitting here as Marina was playing that lovely piece, and I was looking outside, and there's still leaves on the trees. Thank you. And as Marina was playing, it looked like the leaves were dancing in rhythm to exactly what she was playing. That's how connected we are. Everything works together for our highest good. And I'd like to share with you a story, me and my stories. And this is a bit of a sad story, but it's got to happen anyway, so it's all good. And Marnie had a little boy, and his name was Billy. And Billy was sick. And he was so sick that they had to take him to the hospital. They didn't know what was wrong with him. And they kept running tests and doing this and doing that. It's very worrisome. You know how that is, right? When someone you really love is doing well, and you may or may not even know what it is that's wrong with them. And after several weeks, he was diagnosed with a very, very rare and very serious illness. And because this disease was so rare and they didn't really know that much about it, the doctors couldn't say exactly how much longer Billy had to live. But they knew it was a limited time. So every day Marnie would go to the hospital to spend time with her son. And every time she walked into the room, he just looked so sad, so hopeless. And she tried to cheer him up, but nothing seemed to help. And then one day, she walked in and he was sitting up and he was smiling and she's like, "Oh, Mom, you're here." And she leaned over and gave him a hug, and this time he gave her a huge hug back. And it was just awesome. She was so happy and so excited, and she's like, "Billy, what's going on? What's going on with you?" And he's like, So, but here's the deal. Earlier that day, Billy was sitting in his room. This very happy, very pretty lady clown walked into the room. And she took one look at Billy's sad, downcast face and said, "No, no, 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 this will never do. Not at all, not at all. Can't have this." Billy's head drooped even more, and he said, "Yeah, I know. I'm dying. They already told me." And the clown looked at him and said, "That's what I heard, and that's why I'm here." He looked at her and was like, "Huh? Well, you know what it means. It just means you gotta get busy. You don't have time to be sad. Haven't they told you?" The voice said, "Told me? Told me what?" "Oh, dear me, I'm surprised no one's told you. It's the heaven for sick children. I mean, it's way better than where parents get to go. I mean," and she kind of leaned over and whispered in his ear, "In order to get there, you've got to get to work so that you can make it in. And then, of course, you got to follow the rules." "Rules? What rules?" "Well, first and foremost, you got to fill the bag." "What bag?" Billy asked. So the clown reached under her coat and pulled out this bag with brightly colored balloons all over it. She said, "What, this bag, of course. The special one." And so the little boy looked at it and he said, "Well, where do I get one?" "For me, of course." So she handed him the bag. And then, as Billy reached toward the bag, she hesitated a minute and waited, and Billy just looked at her. She kind of raised her eyebrows. He said, "Please?" And she smiled and handed him the bag. So then the clown said, "Now you have to fill the bag with notes. That's how you get your tickets to heaven. And then you gotta build it all the way to the top with tickets." Billy still looked confused.
What do you mean, notes? What kind of notes?
Said, oh, special notes. Special notes. These are notes of all the good things that you do all day long. And then at night, and then at the end of the day, you put all the notes in the bag, and while you're asleep, an angel comes and looks at all the notes you've written, and the ones that are really good will earn you a ticket to the children's heaven. So, Billy kind of thought, wow, that sounds pretty cool. He's like, okay, that sounds good. So the clown's fuzzy curly hair bounced and Ashley nodded and said, yep, it is. But you better hurry up because you know you've already been in here a while and your time's running out, so you really get going. I just hope you can make it. I'm pretty sure you can, but you better get to work. So the clown then rushed out of the room and Billy just stared at that bag. Going to a heaven filled with other kids just like him, he figured it must be the greatest place in the world. Lots of toys, lots of fun, lots of excitement. So he thought, well, sounds good to me. Might as well try to get in. So that's why when his mom came in, he sat up, smiled real big, and gave her a big hug. And so at the end of the day, he wrote on one of the notes, a little tablet of paper that the clown had left, Mommy smiled today. And he tore it up and he put it in the bag. He went to sleep. And the next morning, he couldn't wait to open the bag. So he opened the bag, and sure enough, there's a ticket to heaven. And it was all glittery and shiny and beautiful. It was so exciting. And Billy thought, wow, I think I can do this. And he got excited. So that afternoon, when his mom came in again, he did it all over again. And she smiled, and she was so happy. And he said, Mommy, why don't we call my baby brother Tommy? I haven't talked to Tommy in a long time. And she's like, well, sure. So she got Tommy on the phone, and Billy and Tommy talked, and Billy got Tommy to laugh. And it made Billy laugh, too. And then at the end of the day, he wrote, made Tommy laugh, Mommy smiled again, and put those notes in the bag. The next morning when he woke up, he had two more tickets. And he was so happy and so excited. He thought, oh boy, now I'm really gonna do it. So the next day, every single person that walked in the room, he tried to think of something to do to make them happy, make them smile. Didn't matter if they were a doctor or a nurse or somebody that came in to bring him his lunch or his breakfast, or somebody that came in to empty the waste baskets. He didn't care. He was just having so much fun, and then every time they came, he'd write another note and put it in the bag. And he was so happy and so excited. So time goes on, and his dad heard about how much better Tommy Billy was doing. And so my dad showed up, because Dad had been a little reluctant to go to the hospital. You know, sorry, men, but sometimes men are a little scared of health challenges. So he went and he brought Tommy a chutes and ladders game. And he and his dad played chutes and ladders, and they laughed and they had fun. And then when Dad left, that was another note. And so Billy was just accumulating all kinds of tickets. But that doggone angel that came every night would just arrange those tickets in such careful order, stacked up so neatly, that it just didn't seem like the bag was getting much fuller at all. I mean, time was really slipping by, and he didn't have it but about halfway filled. So he decided, what else can I do? Well,
Strangely enough, by this time, Billy was actually feeling a little bit better. So he asked if he could maybe start going and visiting some of the other kids that were in the hospital. And they said it was okay. So he started going and visiting some of the other children in his area. And sometimes he'd just talk with them and tell them jokes. And sometimes they even wanted to play shoots and ladders. He'd bring his shoots and ladders to me. So he started accumulating more tickets. And he was so happy about it that something really strange happened. He was so cheerful and helpful that instead of getting sicker, Billy was completely healed. And the doctors really didn't know why. Some people said it was because Billy was so happy and friendly that the hospital staff spent extra hours trying to find a cure. And they gave him extra special care because they'd grown to love him so much. Some other people whispered a story about a couple of elderly millionaires who Billy had met and visited, and who were so much happier because of that little boy that they paid for him to have some very expensive experimental treatment. And then there were those who just believed it was Billy's joy and enthusiasm for life that cured him. And the fact is, it was all true. The clown had seen it many times before. When someone puts a bit of heaven in their bag every night, even what seems like a dying existence is transformed into the very best days you've ever had in your life, no matter how long it lasts. And that's the power of zeal. Now, ain't we gonna have fun?
Through and as us.
spirit of zeal, of courage, of enthusiasm. We know it is our divine nature, always with us and tempered by divine wisdom. We feel the light of the sacred presence flowing through our entire being and united with spirit. We silently affirm, I and spirit are one. And now let us remain in this shrine of silence, commune with this holy presence, and feel that oneness. We are so thankful to know that our prayers have been heard and are already answered. We are so grateful for all that we've been given and feel exhilarated as we give, as we have received. Our consciousness of divine zeal has been awakened, and we enthusiastically go forward to do what is ours to do, to serve the divine, to serve this community, and to serve humanity. We listen and we allow our thoughts, feelings, words, and actions to be guided by divine presence. And as a result, we are continuing to grow in consciousness. We are becoming happier, more enthusiastic, and more loving people. It is so, and so it is. Amen.
I don't know if everyone has
has the updated version that we are kind of trying to teach ourselves to use. It's basically the same as we've been saying for years, but it's just got a little more oomph to it. And it reminds us of joy. It reminds us of that enthusiasm. Because as we give, so we receive. So as we enthusiastically give, then the universe says, yeah, you got it. And it enthusiastically gives back to us in the most surprising and fun ways. So let's take our gifts in our hands and repeat together. Divine love as me blesses and multiplies all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. I give joyfully and easily, for the universe is my source, and abundance is my nature. I'd like to turn to in the hymnal 183. Approximately 11:45. See Reverend Anita for any information. The Unity East Church Women's Group is going to meet Thursday, October 20th at 6. We have a guest speaker, Nancy Ballman, the author of Life Choices, Using Astrology in the 21st Century. It's $7 per person. Refreshments will be served, and also you can sign up in the book corner. The other thing is Shoes and Boots for the Homeless. Motor City Mission, which is Reverend Ben's concern, all sizes are needed, especially shoe sizes 12. And Reverend Kelly needs boots for her Divine Life Ministry, sizes 10, 11, 12, and 13. And don't forget Reverend Anita's prayer circle on Wednesdays. Okay, if we'd like to circle up for our prayer peace song, don't forget to move towards the walls so that everybody has a chance to get in the circle.
Have a great week, everybody. And